Hello and welcome back to Going Green. We're going to be meeting some people pursuing their own personal green agenda, and I'm going to be following the afterlife of an aluminium can, a little bit like this one. Now, after collection, my can needs to be sorted from this myriad of recycled materials.
An interconnected conveyor belt system carries it through disc screens, infrared scanners, and magnetic current separators to filter it from paper, plastic, and glass.
Now, these guys are filtering through anything that's not paper, but over here is the can picking room. Well, hopefully our CNN can is going to come through. Oh, there she is! We found our CNN can. Well, as that continues its journey, we're off to meet a man in Manhattan who has a carbon-free commute to work. Some people like to call him a commuter. I like to call him a canuter, as he takes his canoe on the Hudson River to work.
My name is Zach Schwitzky, and I kayak to work. I do this because it's good for the environment, and it's about the only place in Manhattan I can be alone.
The mornings are beautiful, especially this time of year. If I leave early enough, it's foggy, and so, you know, it sort of looks like Gotham, and you got the, you know, sun rising and the city sort of appearing through the fog. So I start in Hoboken Cove, which is at the far north end of Hoboken, and then paddle directly across to Manhattan. For me, it was not a hard decision just because I was so frustrated with the commute. Kayaking checked off a lot of boxes. It doesn't cost us anything. We can come and go as we please. The hours that we keep, it's difficult to get workouts in, you know, in the morning or at the end of the day, so this sort of doubled as great exercise. It's great to be outdoors. We say, you know, half jokingly, but it's sort of New York City's version of nature. People always ask if I do this in the winter, and outside of days where there's ice in the river, I do, because once I start paddling, I'm hot regardless of whatever the temperature is. You should have a life jacket on. But I've never tipped over, never come close to tipping over, so I always feel very safe out there, and obviously being the smallest out there, you just stay out of everybody else's way. And life is so fast, you know, and especially in a city like New York, and you know, when you're on from the minute you wake up to that minute, it's the best way to end a day. Our office used to be on 37th and 10th, and when it was, I would bring the kayak from about 26th Street to the office and have a little trailer, so it was very easy. I'd say if we were anywhere other than New York City, it would be out of the ordinary to see a guy walking with a 15-foot boat behind him, but it was rare that I would hear or see anything that, you know, people were looking at me differently. But I think the biggest benefit to the environment is, you know, there's no emissions. And every other way that I could get across or have gotten across or do get across, there is. So even if it's just, you know, a little bit, it's doing something. Different ways to get across the river, whether that's the ferry or the bus or even driving, certainly don't compare. During commuting hours, sitting in the Lincoln Tunnel, where everything's in there. You see it, feel it, breathe it, and you realize very quickly that, you know, this can't be good for your health, for the environment, for anybody. So, you know, if it's one less car, one less bus ultimately, or hopefully a lot less at some point, that can have very real impacts. Just about everybody I tell says they want to do it with me at some point, even though most haven't taken me up on it, other than my girlfriend, who's a trooper and gets out there every once in a while with me.
Bailing is probably something that most canoeists want to avoid, but they absolutely love it here. And in amongst this total organised chaos, you can see how all this recyclable material has been sorted and separated into the bales. Over here, we've got the paper. Behind me, you can see the plastic. We've got the cardboard. And I've just spotted the aluminium cans. After collection at the local recycling centre, my can joins millions of others from all over Europe on a 4-hour drive north from London to Cheshire. So that's where I'm heading next. This plant is part of the world's largest drinking can recycling conglomerate. So you can see that these bales are coming in thick and fast. From this holding area, the aluminium cans are transferred under this roof, where my can could be turned into a solid aluminium block, ultimately ending up in an aeroplane, car, smartphone, or even back into a can once again. We'll conclude the can's tale in part 3. Also on the menu, we'll serve up a tasty treat from a French chef who hates to see waste. And in Hollywood, it's not just the Hulk who appreciates the merits of green makeup.